everybody. You know what? There is so much juxtaposed joy in the WWE universe that I judge that you and I could judiciously unjumble the jargon for every single letter of the alphabet. And that's just what we're doing. My name is Tom Campbell, and this is Jay on the A to Z of WWE. J is for Jess McMahon, born to Roderick and Elizabeth McMahon from County Galway, Ireland in 1882. They moved to New York to seek out a new life and greater fortune, where Roderick became a hotel owner and Jess, as he grew up, really got into the sporting world. He set up the black baseball team, the New York Lincoln Giants, as well as a boxing circuit that regularly ran shows in Madison Square Garden. Two significant things would happen to Jess McMahon after this. Number one, he alongside Toots Mont would found the Capital Wrestling Corporation that would later become the WWWF. And Jess would father a son by the name of Vince McMahon. More on that a little later on. If your computer screen goes blank, it's just because you can't see this next J, which is, of course, John Cena, West Newbury, Massachusetts' favourite son, who had a career in football and bodybuilding that went to one side when he got bitten by the wrestling bug. Starting out in the wrestling world as the prototype, a sort of half-robot, half-human performer, John Cena would work in OVW until he got the invite to join the main WWE roster in 2002. He would ditch the semi-bionic shtick and fill himself up with ruthless aggression, having a memorable debut match on television against Kurt Angle. Whilst he didn't win, he certainly won a lot of hearts that night. However, the office wasn't massively into what John Cena was all about, and he was very, very close to actually being let go from the company by the end of 2002. It wasn't until Halloween, when he decided to dress up as Vanilla Ice and show off his rapping skills, that his career was very much saved. From there, the Doctor of Thugonomics became a big star in the WWE, becoming the WWE champion at WrestleMania 21. John Cena has done it all at this point. 13 times WWE champion, multiple time World Heavyweight Champion, US Champion, Tag Team Champion, Royal Rumble winner, Money in the Bank winner, and now moving into a huge career in Hollywood. John Cena remains a firm ambassador for WWE, despite the fact that he's not on the regular shows nowadays. He still likes to come back anytime his very busy schedule allows. In fact, he has said in several interviews that he hasn't missed a WrestleMania in quite some time and has no intention on doing so. By God, he's broken in half! Oh, this is bowling shoe ugly! This is a slobber knocker! Stone cold! Stone cold! All calls by our next J, Jim Ross. Good old JR joined the WWF in 1993 after working for the NWA and WCW. He rose his way through the ranks to become the voice of Monday Night Raw during the Attitude Era. JR's had a bit of a rough time on commentary over the years. He's been beaten up, thrown down, fired multiple times. He's even left of his own volition on several occasions. He even got set fire to on at least one occasion. Despite all of this, JR remains a firm fan favorite. He was inducted into the WWE Hall of Fame by his best friend Stone Cold Steve Austin before he finally left the WWE for pastures new. Now, WWE has always welcomed Jim Ross back, but it looks like he's very much got himself a shiny new home in AEW. So whether we'll see him back, we don't know. What will forever remain is that JR was the voice of the Attitude Era in the WWF. When we talk about voices of that era, we have to talk about JR's tag team partner, Jerry the King Lawler, arriving in the WWF around about the same time as JR, but not as a commentator, more as a wrestler, working a program with Bret the Hitman Hart that spanned a good year or so. There was even one moment where they had themselves a Kiss My Foot match, where Jerry Lawler made his foot all disgusting and horrible, thinking that Bret was going to end up kissing it, and Bret ended up making Lawler kiss his own foot. I don't know why I've gone into great detail on the Kiss My Foot match. It did, however, mean that Jerry Lawler had to bring his own personal dentist to get his teeth sorted out. A dentist by the name of Isaac Yankum DDS, who we'll hear about a little bit later on. Whilst Jerry Lawler always prefers working in the ring, his work outside the ring at the broadcast position will be what he is very much remembered for as part of the Attitude Era. He's still there now. He's made a return recently back on Monday Night Raw. And when he is on his A game, there is no finer color commentator than the King. Wrestlers can make good commentators. This guy told us that we fight on Friday nights, Maggle, as Jay is for JBL. John Bradshaw Layfield, starting out as Bradshaw in the WWF, swapped the cigar-chomping Acolyte Protection Agency lifestyle for stocks and shares when he was reborn in 2004 as JBL. This really plays into JBL's real-life persona of somebody who knows the business world inside out. He's even written books about it and everything. So that's probably why he was so comfortable assuming this role, with a combination of sneaky tactics and a devastating clothesline from hell. JBL very quickly ascended on SmackDown in 2004, defeating Eddie Guerrero for the WWE Championship at the Great American Bash. JBL hired his cabinet, consisting of Orlando Jordan and the Basham Brothers, to keep that WWE Championship around his waist. And you know what? Together, they dominated SmackDown for almost an entire year, turning back challenges from The Undertaker, Booker T, Kurt Angle, and The Big Show, before John Cena upset JBL and his cabinet at WrestleMania 21. JBL wouldn't win the big one again, but he would remain in the top flight, feuding with guys like Batista, Shawn Michaels, and Rey Mysterio before knocking it on the head in 2006. As we said at the start, JBL would transition to Friday Night SmackDown. He'd also make the odd appearance on business channels like MSNBC and Fox News, keeping that JBL gimmick alive. An iconic one-time-only match is next, as Jay is for Jailhouse Match. SummerSlam 1991. It's the Big Boss Man versus the Mountie. The US law enforcement versus Canadian law enforcement. It's the Nightstick versus the Cattle Prod. The winner of that match revels in the victory of being the greatest law enforcement in all of the Americas. And the loser has to spend 24 hours in a jailhouse. The Mountie was in his pomp in the run-up to this match, making sure that the police officers who were going to be arresting Big Boss Man when he loses were going to treat him terribly, making sure that they were riled up to treat this man like a criminal when he loses the match. Except he didn't. Except Boss Man won, and the Mountie lost. And from there, we get a piece of wrestling history, which is the Mountie kicking and screaming into the back of a paddy wagon by the police, getting his mugshot taken, getting his fingerprints done, and then being thrown into a jail cell for the night. It is the stuff of legend, and you can watch it on the WWE Network right now. The Jailhouse Match is one of a kind. So who would have sanctioned such a match? Well, chances are it would have been our next Jay, since he was the presiding president the WWF at that time, Jack Tunney. Now, Jack Tunney was the head of Canadian promotions for part of the 80s, where he would run wrestling shows for the NWA and the WWF in Canada. He ended up working exclusively for the WWF, and as a result, his office would be combined with the World Wrestling Federation. To viewers on TV, though, Jack Tunney was known as President Tunney. He wasn't the real president of the company. He was the figurehead that made some of the big decisions from then. This was basically our first ever authority figure in the WWF. That infamous moment when Andre the Giant pinned Hulk Hogan as a result of Earl and Dave Hebner referee shenanigans on the main event, and the moment that saw Andre the Giant give the WWF Championship to Ted DiBiase, it was President Jack Tunney that stripped the belt of DiBiase and said, "Nobody's having this. We're doing a tournament at WrestleMania 4 to determine the new champ." Tunney would vacate the title again at This Tuesday in Texas when he was knocked down during a championship match between The Undertaker and Hulk Hogan. The belt would then be put on the line in the 1992 Royal Rumble match. And Jack Tunney would decree that Bret Hart and Lex Luger went over the top rope at the same time at the end of the 1994 Royal Rumble. He would decree them co-winners, and they would both get an opportunity at Yokozuna's WWF Championship at WrestleMania 10. Just a handful of the things that Jack Tunney saw over as his time as WWF president came to an end in 1995 when the WWF closed their offices in Canada. Jack Tunney left at about the same time as well. And after that, we didn't really see much of Jack Tunney anywhere. However, in an era of wrestling which very much relies on the old evil general manager or good guy commissioner authority type figure, Jack Tunney was the pioneer. We can't blame Jack Tunney for this particular Jay, the junior division. This is quite the tale to tell. So in 2005, Kurt Bauer and a few of the other writers in WWE decided they wanted to make a more conceited effort to make the Cruiserweight division stand out, rebranding it as the Junior Division, very similar to Japan's Super Junior Division. They made a list of some of the great luchadors and Japanese wrestlers that they wanted John Laurinaitis to bring on board to bring this vision to life. For whatever reason, instead of hiring the wrestlers that the WWE writers had asked John Laurinaitis to hire, he instead hired a whole selection of mini wrestlers from Mexico. And by the time the ink had dried on all the paperwork for all of these wrestlers, the deal had already been done. And suddenly they couldn't do what they wanted to do. So now they had this junior division that they had to figure out that wasn't to do with the best cruiserweight wrestlers on the planet. No, it became a mini wrestler division. Not quite sure what happened with that there. It's a bit like, I guess, when you send your dad to the shops and he comes back with everything wrong from the list. Maybe that's what happened there. I don't know. Hey, John, let us know. Inbox me, bro. Accompanied by Childish Match Graphics. I mean, the state of that. The junior division didn't last very long in WWE. You see, they persevered for a short while before Finlay came in, clattered a few of the junior division wrestlers, and they were never spoken of again. It does remain not just an unsolved mystery, but a real moment of absolute job stupidity that this whole thing happened in the first place. And finally, J is for Japan. Now, if you head to the land of the rising sun, you get a very different style of wrestling, a very different discipline, a strong work ethic driven focus from the wrestling over there. And it's a nut that the company have tried to crack for many decades now. In 1990, the WWF teamed with All Japan and New Japan to put on the Wrestling Summit. This featured Tiger Mask and Bret Hart going to a 20-minute time limit draw. We saw Tenryu facing Macho Man Randy Savage, and we saw Andre the Giant team with the legendary Giant Baba to face Demolition. WWE have also run a few flagship shows from Japan, including the WWE Network special Beast in the East, which saw Finn Balor defeat Kevin Owens for the NXT Championship. In fact, the NXT titles changed hands twice in Japan. The other time was when Shinsuke Nakamura pinned Samoa Joe on an episode of NXT to thunderous ovation from the Osaka crowd present. So that's Jay on the A to Z of WWE. Next time, keep your finger off the switch, done. Bye! Hey, thanks for watching. Don't forget to leave a comment in the comment section down below. You can support us on Patreon by going to patreon.com/cultaholic. Lastly, don't forget to hit subscribe and join us.